Now, beside, after the pectoral girdle injuries, let us proceed down from the shoulder right up to the fingertips. The common thing about all fractures and dislocations presenting with pain, swelling, deformity and loss of function, which have to be reduced, retained and rehabilitated and their complications identified and managed, is true for these also. The fracture shaft of humerus occurs at the junction of the upper two-third and lower one-third, and if the fracture is directed downwards and medially, then you can see in the figure that it can entrap the radial nerve which is winding around the lateral border of humerus and plastered to the border by the lateral intermuscular septum. And this involvement can occur if you are trying to close reduce the fracture. So this is called as the Holstein-Lewis syndrome. Radial nerve paralysis must be detected in all humeral fractures by first contact, and primarily leads to a wrist drop, finger drop and thumb drop. The wrist drop is because of the paralysis of the extensor carpi radialis, longus and brevis, and extensor carpi ulnaris. The finger drop is because of the paralysis of extensor indices, extensor digitorum and extensor digiti minimi. And the thumb drop is because of the paralysis of the abductor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis longus and extensor pollicis brevis. The fracture shaft of humerus are closed and without radial nerve involvement is treated by a functional cast brace using the gravity to retain the fracture reduction. Otherwise, or if closed, reduction or retention fails, it is open, reduced and internally fixed by a interlocking nail or a compression nail and plate. The entrapped radial nerve is explored, decompressed, sutured if sectioned, and treated by tendon transfer if it does not recover by 9 months, which is residual paralysis. The motors are pronator teres for dorsiflexion of the wrist, palmaris longus for thumb extension and abduction, and flexor carpi ulnaris for MP joint extension of fingers. These are synphasic transfers. For pronator is associated with wrist dorsiflexion, and palmarflexion ulnar deviation, FCU, and palmaris longus action are associated with the opening grasp, phase of grasp, in which the MP joints are extended and thumb is extended and abducted. So till you are waiting for the residual paralysis, a dynamic cock-up sprint can be used for radial nerve palsy. The soft tissue injuries and fracture and dislocations around elbow presenting with pain, swelling, deformity and loss of function, we will consider the supracondylar fracture as an example. It is of an extension type because when the child falls on the hand with the elbow flexed, the distal fragment extends in relation to the proximal fragment and goes in varus and may override or rotate. Clinically, the relationship of the three bony landmarks is maintained, but it is altered in relation to the humerus. The three bony landmarks are lateral and medial epicondyle and the olecranon process. Both supracondylar ridges are tender, injury to the brachial artery presenting as acute Volkmann ischemia, and median ulnar and radial nerve needs to be ruled out and managed if present. Treatment is by reduction, which is by traction, counter traction on a 30 degree flexed elbow, which is to protect the median nerve. The forearm is prone so that the carrying angle is obliterated and the elbow valgus is maintained. Manipulation is by the thumb of both the hands on the two sides of the olecranon, pushing the distal fragment forward, and the fingers of both hands pushing the proximal fragment backwards. While this pressure is being applied, the elbow is flexed while maintaining the traction 5 degrees short of obliteration of the radial pulse. Reduction, if proved satisfactory by the post-operative X-ray, is retained by above elbow POP cast with a bridge across the elbow for 3 to 4 weeks. When union is diagnosed by lack of localized tenderness and presence of transmitted movements and confirmed radiologically by seeing trabeculae across the fracture site. This is followed by physiotherapy, which is active exercises only. No massage and no passive stretching is allowed to prevent myositis ossificans. Heat therapy can be given by paraffin wax bath or by hot saline fomentation. The delayed complications of supracondylar fracture are chronic Wachmann's ischemia, which is basically a contracture of the flexor digitorum profundus, causing flexion at the MP joint, PIP joint, DIP joint, and wrist. It is treated by Max Page's flexor pronator release. So common flexors are released from the medial epicondyle, and the ulnar head of pronator teres originating from the coronoid process, the ulna, is released, saving the ulnar artery and the median nerve, which are lying posterior and anterior to this head. Also, the median nerve entrapped in the muscle sequestrum of the flexor digitorum profundus and flexor pollicis longus is entrapped because of the necrobiosis of the muscle. And this muscle sequestrum is excised and the nerve is decompressed. This is called as Seddon's operation. Thirdly, the radius and ulna may be shortened, or the proximal and distal row or combined carpectomy can be done to shorten the bones so that the shortened muscles become relaxed. So these are the types of operation, the Max Page, the Seddon's, and bone shortening operations, which are done for the VIC. Besides the VIC, the elbow can be stiff. It can be because of myositis ossificans. There can be malunion, most probably cubitus varus or gunstock deformity, where the carrying angle is obliterated. Now this is prevented if you immobilize in full pronation of the forearm. Then there can be growth disturbances due to associated epiphyseal injury, and so these complications should be diagnosed and managed if they occur. Other possibilities around the elbow are lateral condyle fracture, which is lateral epicondyle, capitulum, and medial lateral half of the trochlea, which rotates because of the pull of the common extensor origin. Then the fracture can be of the medial epicondyle, and this can involve the ulnar nerve. Now both these epicondyles move away from the tip of the olecranon if they fracture, and of course there is localized tenderness. When both condyles fracture from the shaft, it is called as the intercondylar fracture in adult and dicondylar fracture in children. In children, you can also have a slipped humeral epiphysis where extension becomes painful as the epiphysis slips forward, angulates forward. On the lateral view of the X-ray, the humero-epiphyseal angle is above 45 degrees and more than 2/3 of the epiphysis is anterior to the anterior humeral line. In fracture of the capitulum, additional fracture line may be seen on X-ray. Treatment is reduce, retain, and rehabilitate, closed or open, and detect and treat complications. However, an open reduction of fracture of the lateral condyle, the extensor pull causing rotation has to be neutralized, and the growth plane plate ends are accurately apposed and fixed by parallel K wires near the center of the fractured growth plate with tension band for dynamic compression. Now this is essential to accurately oppose the growth plate so that there is no cross union and no disturbance of growth later on. Otherwise the lateral condyle will stop growing, the medial condyles will continue to grow, and there will be an increasing amount of cubitus valgus which will lead to tardy ulnar nerve palsy later on, which will have to be treated by corrective osteotomy and transposition of the ulnar nerve. The posterior dislocation of the elbow can occur with fracture of the coronoid process, capitulum and the head of the radius as the impact against the humerus. Because here the forearm is moving back in relation to the lower end of the humerus. The tip of the olecranon will lie above the intercondylar line with the elbow extended. The treatment is reduce, retain and rehabilitate, closed or open, and detect and treat the complications. The head of the radius in adults and neck of the radius in children present with tenderness below the lateral epicondyle behind the brachioradialis with painful supination pronation. In both cases, the head is exposed between the anconeus and the extensor carpi ulnaris. Supinator is retracted, exposing the annular ligament, and the posterior interosseous branch of the radial nerve is saved by pronating the forearm. The capsule in the annular ligament is incised to expose the head. It is reduced and fixed by a screw or staple in fractured neck of radius found in children, but excised in fracture of the head of the radius found in adults. The proximal end of the remaining radius is filed to smoothen it. The head is reconstituted to confirm that no part remains behind, and then the wound is closed in layers. Olecranon is usually evulsed by the triceps, diagnosed by localized tenderness, palpable gap and loss of active extension. It is confirmed by X-ray and treated by closed or open reduction in retention by cast, compression screw or tension band wiring. Coronoid carrying origins of the ulnar head of the pronated teres, separating the median nerve anteriorly and the ulnar artery posteriorly, flexor digitorum superficialis and insertion of the brachialis is usually open, reduced and fixed by a lag screw, specially saving the nerve and the artery by anterior approach. The dislocation of the head of the radius anterior, posterior, lateral is associated with fracture of the upper third of the ulna, which is angulated in the direction of the dislocation. Now in this particular dislocation you can see that the head is dislocated anteriorly, but the distal fragment is extended in relation to the proximal fragment. So this is called as the extension type of Monteggia fracture dislocation. If the head is dislocated posteriorly, the distal fragment will flex in relation to the proximal head fragment, and that will be called as flexion type of Monteggia fracture dislocation. Now, in very high fractures of the ulna may be associated with dislocation of the head, they are called as Humes fracture dislocation. They usually need open reduction and internal fixation of the fractured ulna by plate, screw and not nails. With the child being lifted from the wrist, the head of the radius subluxates from the annular ligament. This is called as the pulled elbow. This can be restored by fully supinating and pronating the forearm on 90 degree flexed elbow and strapping it in that position. Fractures of both bone of forearm proximal to the insertion of the pronated teres. The proximal fragment has supinator and biceps brachii attached to it. Both are supinators. Biceps is on the flexed elbow and supinator on extended elbow. There is no pronator pull, so the proximal fragment will go into supination. The distal fragment will thus have to be brought into supination to achieve closed reduction. Interposition of the supinator may need open reduction and internal fixation by plate or nail. Exposure is by Henry's approach, dividing the skin and the subcutaneous tissue. The cephalic vein is retracted medially. The lateral cutaneous nerve of forearm is saved. The deep fascia lateral to the cephalic vein is divided, exposing the supinator insertion by retracting the brachioradialis laterally. The radial artery is retracted medially and the radial nerve laterally. And since the radial artery is giving the anterior radial recurrent artery, that artery has to be ligated and divided. The supinator is lifted off subperiostally from the supinator crest to expose the fracture, which is reduced and fixed by a nail or a plate. In fractures distal to the insertion of pronator TE but proximal to pronator quadratus, the proximal fragment is in mid-prone position due to the balanced action of biceps supinator causing supination and pronator teres causing pronation. The closed reduction is thus achieved in mid-prone position and reduction is retained in above elbow POP. If closed reduction fails, open reduction by nail or plate can be done. In fractures within or distal to the pronator quadratus, the reduction is achieved in pronation or of distal fragment in dorsally displaced fractures and supination in palmar displaced fractures. So if the distal fragment is palmar displaced, you plaster in supination. Otherwise, you have to plaster more commonly in pronation. The fracture shaft of radius with dislocation of the distal radioulnar joint is called as Galeazzi fracture dislocation. In fact, distal distal joint can dislocate in all fractures of distal radius, and the triangular disc, ulnar steloid and ulnar collateral ligament can be injured. Treatment is open reduction and internal fixation. Extra-articular fracture, the distal end of the radius can be simple transverse fracture with dorsal radial and supination displacement with overriding causing a dinner fork deformity, the typical and the common collisus fracture. With palmar displacement, you call it the reverse collisus or the Smith's fracture. Intra-articular fracture, the distal radius can be anterior marginal, which is called as Barton's fracture, posterior marginal, radial steroid or distal radio ulnar synostosis. All fractures are treated by reduction, open or closed, retention by POP or internal or external fixation and rehabilitation. We will deal with the collisus fracture in detail. Collisus fracture is a simple transverse fracture of the radius within 3/4 of an inch of the distal articulating surface, sustained by an elderly osteoporosed woman due to fall on an outstretched hand. The distal fragment is dorsoradially and proximally displaced and supinated in relation to the proximal fragment, causing a dinner fork deformity. The radial length is reduced as indicated by a higher radial styloid as compared to ulnar styloid, and the inferior radial ulnar joint is subluxed with or without the fracture of the ulnar styloid or rupture of the triangular disc or ulnar collateral ligament. It is reduced under anesthesia by traction countertraction, pushing the distal fragment ventromedially while pronating, ulnar deviating and palmar flexing the wrist, and the reduction is retained for 4 to 6 weeks by below elbow plaster if stable in pronation or above elbow plaster in pronation if it is unstable. To prevent union and overriding and failure to reduce radial ulnar subluxation, Retention can be done by a distractor or cross K wires, sometimes extending from radius to ulna. Complications are pain, stiffness, and deformity. Pain can be due to ruptured extra EPL at the Lister's tubercle, ununited fracture, fracture scaphoid with or without non-union, avascular necrosis or osteoarthritis, carpal tunnel syndrome, subluxed inferior radial ulnar joint, ruptured triangular disc or ulnar collateral ligament, fracture of the ulnar styloid, sympathetic osteodystrophy and shoulder hand syndrome. Stiffness can be of fingers and thumb, wrist, pronation, supination, elbow and shoulder. Malunion consists of radial dorsolateral supination, overriding shift or tilt correctable by corrective lower radial osteotomy, and inferior radial ulnar dislocation correctable by excision of the lower end of ulna, leaving the ulnar styloid with its triangular disc and ulnar collateral ligament intact, and stabilizing the lower end of ulna by a facial iliotibial band sling against the tender of flexor carpi ulnaris if ulna is sectioned proximal to the attachment of pronator quadratus. This operation is called as the Baldwin's modification of Derrick's operation. Fracture scaphoid is diagnosed by tenderness in the snuff box and X-ray wrist AP lateral oblique at 2 weeks. Because it becomes visible at 2 weeks, it is treated by a scaphoid below elbow POP immobilization for 10 weeks, which covers the knuckle. Complications are non-union, avascular necrosis or osteoarthritis, which is treated by bone grafting, excision of the proximal fragment or radial styloid. There can be lunate or perilunate dislocation, which needs to be reduced, retained and rehabilitated. Now, this will cover up the hand injuries and fracture dislocations in the hand. We begin with the fracture of the ulnar styloid, and remember the attachment of the triangular disc and the ulnar collateral ligament to it. So if this is diagnosed, then the chances of radial ulnar subluxation are high, and the fracture of the collisus which is associated has to be treated with distractor stabilization of that fracture. Next, look at the scaphoid neck fracture. And the blood vessels come from distal to proximal. So this is recognized by tenderness in the snuff box and is visible in the X-ray at 2 weeks. It is treated by a below elbow scaphoid plaster in pen holding position, covering the knuckle for 10 weeks. Complications like non-union is treated by bone graft and Herbert screw fixation. Avascular necrosis, osteoarthritis treated by excision of the proximal fragment or the radial styloid or the fusion of the wrist. Then you see the Bennett or the Schaffer's fracture, which is sustained because the backfiring of a car engine when handles used to be used to start the car. It needs open reduction and internal fixation. Sometimes it can be fixed by closed reduction and fixation by percutaneous K wires. MP dislocation or IP dislocation is characterized by buttonholing as the head passes through the soft tissue, specially inclined to hold it and prevent it from sliding back. So to relax the buttonhole, you have to flex the MP joint and push the metacarpal head rather than pull. So if the lock, the button holding is not relieved, then you may need open reduction to reduce the dislocation. Then you will see the lunate dislocate anteriorly into the carpal tunnel, or all carpals dislocate anteriorly, leaving the lunate in correct position against the radius. So there can be a lunate or a perilunate carpal dislocation. Then there can be fractures of the metacarpal or fractures of the phalanges, which are treated by garter splint, that means joining adjoining fingers across with the fractured finger or the fractured radial. Then there can be avulsion fracture of the insertion of the extensor slip in the distal phalanx, and this can lead to the typical mallet finger, the flexion deformity of the DIP joint. Whenever there is a breach of skin in the hand, you have to be careful to avoid secondary healing across joints, because that would cause contracture because of fibrosis. Similarly, tendon suturing is never done across pulleys. You may have to use a graft to bypass the pulley and then suture distal to the pulley and proximal to the pulley. So this is the finish of everything that is asked from shoulder downwards in the upper limb.